first in our series of conversation for this academic year, featuring Phelim Kine. Before I introduce the speaker, I have a couple of program notes and a couple of announcements. First, on the program notes, please stay tuned. We have other exciting events coming up. One is a conversation on artificial intelligence and human rights, which is the theme of the theme for this year for the center, which is in schedule for November 10th. And we also have a panel coming on December 10th in celebration of Universal Declaration on Human Rights Day, which will focus on discourses of exclusion and how these impact human rights advocacy. More details on both events to follow. And there are a couple of other events that we are discussing about putting on our agenda. We will let you know. Now, my announcements, please put your mics on mute during the talk and bear in mind that the event is being recorded. Now, it is a great pleasure to welcome Phelim Kine, which some of you, the old timers at the center, know that he was scheduled originally to address us as part of our conversation series last April, but unfortunately we had to cancel that due to the pandemic. And to welcome him in his new capacity, because at that time he was working for Physicians for Human Rights. Now Phelim is working for Mighty Worth, and he's the director for Asia for that group. Phelim has extensive experience in human rights. He has previously worked in Human Rights Watch's division from 2007 to 2018, and was also director of research and investigations at Physicians for Human Rights from 2018 to 2020. And this is only part of his resume. So we are delighted to have him with us today to address the topic Human Rights at the Age of Darkness, Autocracy, Inequality, and the Climate Crisis. Without further ado, Phelim, welcome, and the floor is yours.
Thank you so much. And I thank you very much for joining us today. It's a privilege to be the first speaker. I apologize and regret that we cannot be in the same place. But I want to I want us to all stay safe. So I urge you all to maintain those best practices to ensure that we do get through this to the other side. I come to you today as someone who has worked in the human rights field for the better part of 13 years in a variety of capacities, and I think it's been something of a journey, and this journey is reflected somewhat in the title of this talk, Human Rights at the Edge of Darkness, which I apologize, it is also, that's part of the title for one of the Star Trek series films, but I'm hoping that there aren't any IPR issues, but I think it is appropriate given the moment that we're in right now. Autocracy, inequality, and the climate crisis. It's a really easy one to thread together in 30 minutes, so I'll do it. But I want to start by just saying how I come to this work and this experience. I graduated from with a Bachelor of Arts with a fairly, at the time, unpromising degree in sociology. And my career began when I went to Taiwan to make money to pay off my student debt. And I paid off my student debt pretty quickly, and I started studying Mandarin Chinese, and I eventually got into the news business working for a local English paper. And that began this journey of me working in places that all had a similar thread, and that is they were all post-authoritarian states in which the citizens of those countries were kind of struggling to emerge from the really horrific impact of what in some cases decades of curtailment and sort of routine abuse of their rights. And that really had a very deep impact on me in terms of someone living in these countries. And basically a lot of my reporting as a journalist in Taiwan, which was under a ruthless dictatorship for more than 40 years, working in Cambodia, in the, you know, still the ruins of the post-Khmer Rouge period, working in Indonesia, which went through its own lengthy decades of vicious authoritarian rule, and working in China, which of course is an authoritarian one-party state, was at the time, remains so, and is even more resilient. And what I learned from that is that viscerally, you know, what is the impact? What are human rights? And what is the impact in terms of their curtailment? And as a journalist, I realized the limits of journalism. I went into journalism with kind of the best intentions. You know, there's this quote from H.L. Mencken that the purpose of the real purpose or the best purposes of journalism is to comfort the afflicted and afflict the comfortable. And it suggests a certain social justice element to journalism, which I think is journalism at its best. And we are seeing a lot of it in these times, even at a time when journalism is under attack and imploding from the economic effects of the digital age. But I realized the limits of journalism, that journalism can only do so much. And this was brought home to me when I was working for the Phnom Penh Post in the late 1990s, when I did a story about a victim, a woman who was a victim of one of the more vicious crimes when I was in Cambodia. There was a series of attacks, of acid attacks, in which the young mistresses of powerful men, who were by definition linked to the Cambodian People's Party, the dictatorial one-party state that runs Cambodia under Hun Sen, that the wives of these men would essentially detain these young women and douse them in hydrochloric acid in a way that, so if they survived, they would be irreparably harmed and scarred, and they would usually die just because of the extent of their injuries and the lack of adequate medical attention. But I realized that I did a story about this, and I was able to thread the needle between the victim and the perpetrator in a way that there was crystal clear that there was, you know, there was agency, there were witnesses. And I was able to market this story as a journalist and a freelance journalist to the Washington Post. And I was really excited about that, because obviously it was high profile, there was an ego element to it. But also I thought, this can change things. Now we'll get some kind of impact. Now there can be redress or accountability. And of course, what happened is the story went out, I got paid for my contribution to the Washington Post, and nothing ever happened. And I realized that journalism is essential, but inadequate in terms of bringing about meaningful change. And I saw that the people who were bringing about meaningful change were human rights activists, and the people who I was kind of rubbing elbows with in Phnom Penh and in Jakarta and Beijing and in Taipei, Taiwan, these people who worked for organizations like Amnesty International, who worked for organizations like Human Rights Watch, these are the people who are connecting research, which is the basis of journalism, with advocacy, making change happen by ensuring that people who have power, people who can exert leverage, bring about the necessary accountability. And that's the fundamental concept of modern human rights, in the sense that there are victims, there's a crime, and there is some move toward bringing about accountability. And what we're seeing, and what I hope to unpack very quickly here, is that there are obvious limits to that, and that the model of human rights that has been overwhelmingly pursued has unfortunately overlooked the key issue of economic, social, and cultural rights, which we see that the absence or deficit of that has contributed to some of the very serious social and political issues that we are grappling with today as a country and as a world. So that's an introduction. I want to share my screen very quickly, and it's imperfect, but I hope you see it. I want to start this, we're in New York, and all the best stories are New York stories. And I want to start at sort of the nadir of human rights. And I want to remind everybody that in 1730, in the 1700s up until the early 1800s, there New York was a slave trading city, that there was a slave market at the foot of Wall Street, near the corner of Wall Street and Pearl Street. If you go down there, it's outside where the Verizon store is now. The actual wall that delineated Wall Street was built by slaves. in the 1700s and up until the early 1800s, up to 40% of New York residents were slaves. The economy of the city of New York was built on slavery. And if you've been following at all, the New York Times amazing 619 project, 619 marking when the first African slaves came to the shores of what is now the United States. This was the beginning of what has evolved into what they refer to as low road capitalism, that many of the elements of plantation slavery has been applied to how capitalism is applied here in the United States. So this is where we start at the bottom. And maybe we have a sense that given what we know now, that there have been changes, that there is no longer slavery in the United States, but there are still major aspects of the legacy of slavery that are unaddressed, that to a large extent fall within this idea of accountability, redress, compensation, and that in terms of the economic legacy of this on the descendants of slaves. So I want to move forward 211 years and 80 blocks and keep it in New York, 68th Street, West 68th Street. This is where then President Franklin Delano Roosevelt, January 1941, rolled out this idea of the four freedoms. This idea that as the world was falling into this abyss of global conflict and this conflict that's characterized by democratic states against authoritarian or totalitarian states, the Nazis specifically, that there needed to be a ideological framework for what differentiates democracies and how and why democracies should survive and how they ensure that they don't become authoritarian states. And this was the idea of the four freedoms: freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from want, freedom from fear. Freedom from want, of course, being this idea of individuals and citizens having the essential elements of economic life guaranteed to them, that it's made a right. In 1940, so the four freedoms are well known. They're discussed, they're part of every, you know, introductory human rights course. What's less well known is that 3 years later in 1944, FDR rolled out his Economic Bill of Rights, which was specifically directed at the idea that went beyond this idea of civil and political rights, your freedom of speech, freedom of worship, freedom from fear, from the state, that he posited that it needs to go beyond that. And he stated that economic rights were so important because, I quote him, we have come to a clear realization of the fact that true individual freedom cannot exist without economic security and independence, and that men who are hungry and unemployed are easily led into or seduced by authoritarianism. Now, that Economic Bill of Rights kind of didn't go anywhere. FDR died. And what we got by 1948 in the aftermath of the war was the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, UDHR, which was a phenomenal document. This was the first document that stated plainly and specifically that all humans have essential universal rights by the nature and because they're human, regardless of their gender, regardless of their creed, regardless of their religion. This was something that was really revolutionary. This was the founding document of the United Nations in the post-war period. But it was limited by the fact that it's aspirational. This was something that most, not all, but most states signed on to for that founding of the United Nations. But the devil was in the details in terms of what did that mean in terms of what states did or do. And it would take almost three decades for those specifics to be ironed out in two following documents. In 1976, we had the promulgation of the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights. And the International Covenant on Economic, Social, and Cultural Rights. So notably, we had two documents about two different types of rights. the International Covenant on Economic, Social, Cultural Rights obviously referred to those ideas that Franklin Delano Roosevelt unrolled in terms of this idea of freedom from want, in terms of recognizing that true individual freedom cannot exist without economic security and independence. I need to emphasize here that it's Eleanor Roosevelt in that photo, and that Eleanor Roosevelt was the prime driver behind this, behind the UDHR. And it's important to recognize that this is not something was FDR's, that in terms of recognition of gender parity and gender recognition, that this is something that a woman steered. But I think it's important to realize that to a large extent, the UDHR focused on the civil and political rights, the freedom from fear, the freedom of worship, the freedom of speech. And to a large extent, that's because in the post-war period, human rights, in terms of how they were interpreted and how they were discussed, was to a large extent in the context of the Holocaust and its aftermath, this whole idea of never again. And we can never repeat this horror that the Nazis inflicted on Jewish people, on Roma people, on LGBTQ people, on political dissidents, that this is something that needed to be the priority in terms of human rights. Now, having said that, despite that idea, and again, it was aspirational, and despite that recognition that people needed to be protected from the worst excesses of their governments, particularly authoritarian governments, the UDHR and whatever constituted human rights recognition and advocacy at the time did not protect the estimated 500,000 Indonesians who were massacred as part of an anti-communist pogrom in Indonesia in 1965 and 1966. This is something to a large extent that the Western powers of the time, the United States and the United Kingdom, turned a blind eye to, if not implicitly or explicitly encouraged. So we also have this element of how human rights are interpreted and applied selectively due to the perceived perceived restrictions of realpolitik. I want to point out that none of the architects or the perpetrators of those 500,000 to 600,000 deaths in Indonesia have ever been brought to justice. And in fact, their progeny are still firmly lodged in the power structures in Indonesia. It's also worth noting that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and what constituted human rights advocacy didn't save or protect the 1.7 million Cambodians who died under the Khmer Rouge regime between 1975 and 1978. And this isn't just ancient history in terms of the 60s and 70s. We had a massacre of 800,000 Tutsi Rwandans in 1994 at the time when President Bill Clinton was in office. This again shows the limitations of the ability or willingness of the international community to act decisively to protect the most essential rights of citizens, of individuals, of humans, which is the right to life. Now, this is the 1990s. This is 1994. I think it's worth noting that the 1990s, in spite of this, or perhaps because of it, by the mid to late 1990s, this had become really the high point, the heyday of the international human rights movement. This is when organizations like Amnesty International, Human Rights Watch, organizations such as like Global Witness, the human rights work of organizations such as Oxfam really reached critical mass. And human rights became part of and was a key part of statecraft. Speaking strictly from the United States perspective, in the 1990s, it was common for trade agreements and trade relations with states to include specific human rights benchmarks. This was a constant irritant in U.S.-China relations for years. And it wasn't until later in the 90s that the United States lifted its benchmark human rights requirements for China. But while they were in place, they actually did have impact, that there was a level of accountability even by a resolutely one-party authoritarian state. I have met numerous former Chinese political prisoners who have told me how they can recall to the day when their treatment improved in some way. The food got better. They were harassed or tortured less. And then upon release, they realized that that was the day, or within days of, say, Amnesty International issuing an urgent alert about an individual, that human rights organizations really did have juice in terms of bringing about or influencing change. And there was also kind of a romantic element to this, in the sense that the human rights movement had heroes or heroines. I hope you all recognize Aung San Suu Kyi, who was for a long period and part of my formative time as someone in journalism and who transitioned to becoming a human rights researcher and advocate, a real symbol of defiance of authoritarian brutality and a symbol of respect and defense of universal human rights, the right to life, the right to be heard, the right to be free from being terrorized by the state. There is a postscript and a sequel to this story with Aung San Suu Kyi, which is coming, spoiler alert. But the 1990s were also important in that this is when the basic infrastructure of the Universal Declaration of Human Rights, the International Covenant on Civil Political Rights, and the International Covenant on Economic and Social Cultural Rights, which are sort of like the motherships of human rights documentation and standards for international law, really grew and spawned a wide variety of new interpretations of rights that expanded. So specific interpretations and defense and outlining of rights for children, for women through covenants, International Covenant for the Rights of Women, International Covenant for the Rights of Children. We have international covenants on the rights of people disabled, people with disabilities. We also have this infrastructure of human rights in terms of special rapporteurs, these UN experts on issues ranging from indigenous rights to the right to clean water, the right to a clean environment. And this is something that, while not embraced by a large number of states, has been really important in laying a foundation of law or proto-law in terms of laying down standards that United Nations protocols are required by states to adopt and integrate into their laws. So, and that starts with the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights, which the Chinese government has never ratified, to give you an example of the weakness of these things, and the International Covenant on Economic and Social Cultural Rights, which the US government has never ratified. So it's never had to become part of law. And those are just two sort of prime examples. Two other issues that are really important to mention is that there could be, in the 1990s, there grew this much more robust infrastructure for this idea of accountability, that if the lesson of the Holocaust was never again, well, that failed. That failed the Indonesians, it failed the Rwandans, it failed the Cambodians. Then the ethos or the unofficial motto of the human rights movement was, someday you will pay. This was the message to human rights abusers. And that's where we saw the rise of the internet and the formation of the International Criminal Court, for example. We also saw the rise of concepts like responsibility to protect, R2P, this idea in international law that states have a right to intervene in situations in which the citizens of a country are in imminent threat of gross, egregious, mass human rights abuses or death. And this was invoked to a certain extent in terms of the international intervention in Libya several years ago, for example. We've also saw the rise of this idea of universal jurisdiction, this idea that was spearheaded by a very courageous Spanish judge, Garzon, which held or holds that those implicated in the most serious crimes, war crimes, crimes against humanity, it doesn't matter where they are in the world, any responsible justice or a judicial system can and should take action against them. And we have seen that this universal jurisdiction clause has had impact. It's something that keeps this man, the now very elderly Henry Kissinger, it makes him ponder and plan his international travel very carefully because he is implicated in criminal activities going back to Chile, Cambodia, that might constitute crimes against humanity. Christopher Hitchens, by the way, late Christopher Hitchens has written extensively about Kissinger and his culpability in this regard. We've also seen, for example, how courts have, in places like Spain, have taken cases filed by Tibetan nationals against senior Chinese leadership officials for the alleged abuses of the Tibetan minority in China. We've also seen most recently how in Germany, the Germans have issued arrest warrants for senior Syrian military officials based on filings by Syrian Germans or Syrians in Germany for violations, gross violations of human rights in the Syrian civil war in Syria. So these are things that still have bite, have had bite and are really important. So what happened? That was the 1990s, that was a heyday. What happened is this, to a large extent. 9/11 sparked the quote unquote war on terror, which spawned egregious human rights abuses, such as this depiction of torture of a detainee at Abu Ghraib in Iraq. And the war on terror, basically, the United States interpreted, the United States government at the time interpreted its war on terror as giving it freedom to violate one of the most basic freedoms, and that is, and rights, and that is the right to be free from torture. And so we saw this issue of renditions of these black prisons of the United States and its allies being involved in the abduction and then torture, sometimes over months, of terrorist suspects linked to 9/11 and other terrorist acts. Why was this important? Well, first, obviously imperfect and at times hypocritical as it was, it has been, the United States has traditionally been also an international standard bearer of human rights. It's a debatable point, but there's lots of evidence to indicate that that has been the case. And this basically was a gift to authoritarian regimes and human rights abusers because they were able to point to the United States and point and say, look, you're just like us. You see, there is no right, there's no wrong. There's just governance the way we see fit to protect ourselves. And this, of course, this is how Putin runs Russia. This is his implicit or explicit line in terms of justifying what the Russian government does. This has done incalculable damage to human rights advocacy internationally. I have been in meetings with Chinese officials following 9/11, following these revelations, in which they've turned to me and said, who are you to say this? You American, look what you've done. Who are you to lecture us? Who are you to finger wag us on human rights? So whatever high ground there might've been was demolished by that. The other thing that's really important has been the rise of China economically, which has been wonderful for lifting millions, hundreds of millions of Chinese out of poverty. And it has created what has been called this idea of the Beijing consensus, this idea that economic development for struggling developing countries, that you can and perhaps should make a choice between providing the rights of sustainability, the rights of livelihood, so housing, food, medical care, that can and should come first and a priority, and civil and political rights, such as the media freedom, freedom of speech, freedom of association, they can wait, or they're not as important, that your priority should be development, and development is by whatever means necessary, and if that means you need to curtail or forbid certain rights, then so be it. And this is not a uniquely Chinese idea. This is an idea that was touted by Singapore in the 90s as well, under former Singapore Prime Minister Lee Kuan Yew, and it still is to a certain extent. And it was termed, and it came under this rubric of Asian values, this idea that Asians have different values and interpretations of rights, and therefore we need not follow this idea of universal human rights that has been promulgated in the Universal Declaration of Human Rights and other mechanisms. And to me, what I would say is that, you know, I've spent enough time in Asia to say that I think my interpretation, you know, Asian values are like the equivalent of the Holy Roman Empire. You know, Holy Roman Empire was neither holy nor Roman. And Asian values vis-a-vis human rights were neither Asian nor were they values. They were essentially, attempts to justify dictatorial autocratic rule. What else happened? I think the other thing is that what we've seen is that we've seen how our heroes or heroines have failed us. We have seen how in multiple countries, how those who stood for and were symbols of human rights have been shown to not be so in the present day. And I think that one of the most pertinent examples is Aung San Suu Kyi, one of my personally former, you know, personal heroes or heroines, symbols of freedom and universal human rights, and who now stands on the side of the murderers of the Rohingya in 2017, and goes to the International Court of Justice in The Hague to seek to deny allegations of genocide that have been brought against Myanmar by Ghana. The other thing that has undermined the human rights movement is that it's more and more evident that we are in a moment in which the costs of ignoring economic and social rights has come at a profound price that cannot be ignored anymore. You remember the warning that FDR gave in 1944, that those people who are hungry and unemployed are easy prey for authoritarianism. That's certainly one argument, but also we see in this moment this gross inequality, this obviousness that we see on the streets every day, that the system doesn't work in a way that the majority benefit. And so, you know, we first saw these articulations with the Occupy movement with Zuccotti Park in New York, which spread worldwide. And this is something that is much more an issue. And to a large extent, this is something that international human rights organizations have underplayed, have not concentrated on to the extent that they could and should have. And there's a real good argument for that. The international human rights movement was all about preventing atrocities, preventing people from being tortured, preventing and addressing the bleeding wound, and addressing issues like economic inequality have always been argued to be much more complex, much more difficult to manage in terms of how do you address government policy in terms of how they spend their money, how they tax their people, how they don't tax their people. And the bleeding wound has been interpreted as being that so urgent that this has been overlooked. And that's a reasonable argument. But it does indicate how, to a large extent, international human rights organizations are playing catch up in terms of trying to engage with this issue meaningfully. The other issue is that we have seen around the world how democratic states have fallen prey to the rise of demagogues peddling nativist rhetoric that essentially identifies elements of the population as the other, that are not worthy of or not worthy of being accorded the rights of being human. In the United States, of course, we've seen that with regards to immigration policy that has put children into cages and seen the United States completely steamroll its obligations under international law to respect the right of asylum, the right of people to cross the border to seek asylum through an established process. And that has caused incalculable pain and suffering for huge numbers of people at the southern border. It's also seen the rise of these type of autocratic demagogues, nativist demagogues in places like the Philippines. I've spent a lot of time in the Philippines, so I meant there's a photograph of Trump with Duterte. Duterte is a very popular elected leader who was elected on a platform that he would kill thousands of Filipinos in the name of a quote unquote war on drugs. And he has delivered. More than 20,000 Filipinos have died in this campaign. He remains relentlessly very popular. And absolutely, he operates with impunity. And this tells you how the traditional, this dynamic is difficult because the traditional lens of human rights has been this idea of helping and assisting hostage populations, populations held hostage by abusive authoritarian regimes. And now we're dealing with popular democratically elected regimes that egregiously abuse the rights of a certain minority. And in the Philippines, it happens to be people who are perceived to be drug users, which turns out to be anyone who's poor and lives in the slum. The other issue is, of course, what we're living through now. And I won't waste any time underscoring the fact that the coronavirus pandemic and how COVID-19 affects certain populations has laid bare the economic inequalities in this country and others, and what it means in terms of access to health, in terms of essential levels of health among communities, and their vulnerability to serious illness and their ability to seek care and pay for care. This is what we are living through right now. The other issue I want to think about, so this is where I've been as a human rights advocate and a human rights researcher. I've kind of been on the front lines of these sort of battles. And I have recently transitioned to the environmental sector. And that's because for me, it became very, very clear over the last couple of years since the release of the International Panel on Climate Change report, I think 2 years ago, that said, we have 12 years to address the issue of climate change, or there will be irreversible extinction level damage done to the world, done to the human population. So for me, as I grapple with this and I come to this as someone who's like the father of a five-year-old, so it's not just me, I'm looking at my family and realizing that even the best battles against the most pertinent and egregious human rights issues right now, they need to be waged, but we also need to be paying much more attention on the issue of climate, on climate change. I work for an organization called Mighty Earth. It's a DC-based campaigning organization that focuses laser-like on the issue of deforestation in Latin America and in Southeast Asia. As you know, from the last couple of months, the world's burning. The Amazon's burning. The West Coast is burning. This is climate change in action. It's also how the economic model that we have now works, that the private sector in league with governments can and does have the right to bulldoze what are the treasures of humanity that are carbon sinks, that once they're gone, they will create savannas that will accelerate the move toward much more serious climate change cascades. And I'll just give you an example. And why should we care about this? What's the link to us right now? We're all under lockdown to varying degrees, and our lives have been utterly disrupted because, quite likely, according to epidemiologists and scientists, a bat found its way into contact with a civet cat or a pangolin. And that exchange of viral substances made its way to a wet market, a wildlife market in Wuhan, China. And that's where the pandemic arguably began. This is not a new story. This is how SARS began in the early 2000s. This is the story of Ebola. This is the story of HIV/AIDS. This is the story of MERS. And there are credible estimates and calculations by credible scientists that as the Southeast Asian rainforests burn, the vast majority of bat populations are going to relocate. And you can bet that they're going to relocate to the areas that are expanding. And those are human population urban areas. So unless we address the issue of climate change as a visceral issue of human rights, of human survival. We are not going to, this will not be our last pandemic. This will just be our first in our lifetimes. And not to mention the fact that the climate refugees that we're going to be seeing on our borders are going to be almost overwhelming, that we need to address this now proactively before it becomes something that is simply beyond control. And we're already playing catch up and trying to mitigate the worst of what is already to come. Thank you. I hope I didn't go too much over time. I'm going to get rid of my screen now and thank you. And I'm happy to take whatever questions you may have. Thank you.
Phelim, thank you for your remarks. The floor now is open for questions and or comments.
Yeah, questions, comments, or challenges. You know, yeah. I'm positing here, so.
Yeah. Anybody? Silence. Okay. Phelim, maybe.
Professor, you muted yourself.
Phelim, as we are waiting for somebody else to jump in, let me start by asking you a question.
Yeah.
I'm glad that you raised this issue of how late has the human rights movement reflected in the work of major human rights organization mm-hmm. has been in addressing issues of socioeconomic disempowerment, despite the fact that FDR, as you correctly pointed out, had put it on the agenda a while ago. Now, and of course, more organizations are trying to do that now, but from your experience as a human rights activist, shouldn't that entail also for major human rights organizations change their advocacy approach from what, at least in the global north, is a prevailing model of collecting data and lobbying policymakers or exposing abuses to more grassroots-oriented work and try to build constituencies on the ground and try to learn something from social movements that are trying to do this? So should they be in a nutshell more constituency-oriented and try to build bases for support and try to advance the human rights lens through that and try to basically generate constituencies that they can mobilize on critical junctures?
Yeah, that's a great question. I'm going to unpack that in a couple of ways. And the first thing is, like, you touched on something I should have mentioned, and that is, you know, the modus operandi for the international human rights movement, from the 90s when it started to get critical mass, was based on this concept of name and shame. It was based on this idea that if you do credible gold star research on abuses and you expose it, then you will shame the perpetrator into changing it. And it used to work. It worked with China, it worked with multiple countries. This actually used to work. It was a credible tool in the toolbox. But we are now in an era in which we're beyond shame. That no longer works. You can expose, to a large extent, you can expose as much as you want. And the reflex is, that's fake news, or you're biased, or it didn't happen, or we're just not listening. And the second thing is, I just want to point out that Amnesty International had, I think going back almost a decade, had something they called the Demand Dignity campaign, which was all about poverty. It was focused on this. I can't speak to how it worked out. I think they've kind of moved on from that, but it was a recognition by a major international human rights organization. Amnesty is the biggest human rights organization in the world. They have like a budget that's like 10 times that of Human Rights Watch. It's a mass mobilization. I agree with what you're saying. I mean, there has traditionally been this kind of a parachute model, you know, like sort of coming in and like finding out stuff and then presenting and kind of getting out. And I think that, you know, Human Rights Watch, where I spent, you know, many great years, it addressed that early on. Like everyone who works for Human Rights Watch, you know, they're based in, you know, the Indonesian guy is in Indonesia, our Filipino is in Philippines. They have this model. It's not quite a mass mobilization model because that's kind of like a whole different toolkit. And and I think it's, there are other organizations that do that type of thing. But, and I just want to say, and I know that's not the most satisfactory answer, but I also want to say that there really is a value in having an organization that is international, be able to kind of provide air cover in terms of research and advocacy when the people on the ground are under siege, that they're silenced, that they can't speak out, and they need, you know, this international exposure in order for change to happen. And, you know, that was my experience with the Philippines under Duterte. It's also, you know, increasingly the model for how things are playing out in Indonesia today. So I think there is value to this, but I will just say that I think that the human rights movement needs to learn lessons along those lines and soon. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay. And I'll say Human Rights Watch has this new economic and social rights division, so they've mm-hmm. they've plunged into this too, but it's fairly new.
Yeah. Just before I see a couple of questions. Just want to add, you are absolutely correct about Amnesty International, and from major NGOs, at least I'm aware of the Global North, the only one that try at least to maintain some kind of a membership approach and try to mobilize their constituency, but you know, kind of stood out yeah. among other major yeah. NGOs in that perspective. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Now, I think we have a question. Maybe I can read it, or do Juan? Juan, do you want to basically verbalize the question that you put in chat? Juan? Okay, I don't know if Juan can hear us, but here it is. Among your work experiences, what has been the most challenging one to deal with on reporting and advocating on? Also, when it comes to climate change and advocacy, what do you think should be the role of the media and human rights group in communicating effectively on how to address climate change to the public and mobilize more people and pressure governments?
Thank you, George. Thank you, Juan. Great questions. So I would say for me, my experience, I think the most challenging one, and I think the most kind of emotional one, was dealing with the Philippines and the drug war. I'd been working in the Philippines for several years already. I was supervising our Filipino colleague in Manila. So I spent a lot of time in Manila. I got to know a lot of journalists. Here's why it was so difficult. The Philippines had one of Asia's most robust civil society organizations. Like they had this great civil society sector, human rights, economic rights. They also had incredible journalists, or have incredible journalists, and they have this amazing tradition of really deep dive in investigative journalism, fearless. And it was a democracy. It was this democracy that had thrown off this this dictatorship, the Marcos dictatorship in the late 80s with this people power movement. It was a success story. And then to see the Philippine people elect this man, it was a plurality. He didn't have a majority, but it was a plurality of the vote. And then undertake this absolutely barbaric mass murder of some of the poorest, most marginalized citizens in plain view. It was astounding to see that. And it was one of these things that's like, if only we'd known, it was in the front page of every newspaper for months, you know, and what can you do about that? That shows you how international diplomacy, the limits of the human rights movement in terms of dealing with that kind of situation. And I say also personally, because President Duterte actually he personally threatened to kill me. He threatened to publicly execute me in his hometown the next time I come to the Philippines. And that was several years ago. And last year he adjusted that threat and said, if I come, that he would publicly slap me. So maybe that means progress. Like maybe I just say it's like a warming of relations, but it was kind of jarring. In terms of your question, comes to climate change and advocacy, the role of media and human rights groups. I think that the tools and the information has been out there. We have known that we've known about climate change since 1989. The science has been there. We have known and been documenting how climate change in the triangle nations of South, Central South America, which is the majority of the people coming to the United States to seek asylum, that these areas have been pummeled by climate change. These are places where it doesn't rain anymore. We know that there's good evidence to indicate that part of what fueled the Syrian civil war was rooted in climate change in terms of long drought that led to extreme privation and lack of affection for the government. There's also research about how what the Rohingya suffered in 2017 in northern Rakhine state in Myanmar also had its roots in terms of what climate change is doing to the land, access to resources. So we've known this, and we know that there are we have known for a long time that the human rights victims of tomorrow and yesterday and 10 years ago, I'd say tomorrow, but now are climate refugees. They're people running from what the climate is inflicting on them. And there has not been a fast or robust enough response to that, I think, by the human rights community. And, you know, Human Rights Watch, they have an amazing refugees team, but it's understaffed. And they really need to, I think that international human rights organizations really need to step up because this is just gonna get worse. I hope that helps.
I have a quick question regarding disability law in the Asian countries you had stayed in, in the Philippines and so, just because I don't know very much about it.
Yeah.
And so first of all, do their legal systems kind of address disability rights as a whole? And if so, to what extent? And Right. Kind of, we have the ADA here, but do they have a separate bar bill that guarantees these rights for these people?
That's a great question. Thank you for that question. So I'd say this. So the world now has this convention on the rights of people with disabilities. And these conventions, like the ICCPR and the Covenant on Social and Economic Rights, the plan or the protocol is that states integrate them into their, that they sign them, they ratify them, and then they integrate them into domestic law. And that isn't done perfect, that rarely happens. So they exist on paper, they're aspirational, they can be leveraged for local and international human rights organizations to try to bring about meaningful change. But in terms of how it affects law, particularly I would say my experience in Asian countries, except for Taiwan, which is really stellar in all rights, but also in terms of disability rights. You know, in most places in Asia, the idea of a curb cut, which is sort of the foundational recognition or symbol of disability rights in our lives, even that doesn't exist. And, Human Rights Watch has this amazing disabilities program where they advocate for the rights of disabled. And, one of the things in terms of your question, what happens, one thing that in Human Rights Watch has worked on is this idea, in Indonesia, it's called pasang. And pasang means that people who have mental disabilities, because there's no infrastructure to take care of people who are bipolar or schizophrenic or have any types of mental psychotherapy issues, they end up being chained or tied up somewhere. It could be behind someone's house. It could be in a shack. And also what passes for sort of mental facilities, very often these are people who are literally chained to a bench so that they, under the idea they won't hurt each other, hurt themselves or other people. And of course, this is this is medieval, but this is at the level of engagement on this in multiple countries. If you go to the Human Rights website, go to the disabilities page, you'll see it. It's pretty tough stuff, but they're doing great stuff.
Thank you.
I have a question, a quick one, sort of. So can you hear me?
Yes,
great, thank you. And by the way, hello everybody, nice to see you all. Sorry about my camera, I'm having camera troubles, but basically when you mentioned FDR's freedom from want and the susceptibility to authoritarianism, I mean, right now we're all kind of technically living under authoritarianism of our employer. For example, you know, we have, even when we have formally the freedom of speech to criticize our government, you know, if we go on social media and write nasty things about our boss, we will probably get fired and lose our job, and then we will not have that freedom from want anymore. So, and often these very civil rights that, you know, that were basically created by middle class or like upper class liberals in the 19th and the 18th century during the Enlightenment, you know, people who were wealthy and well off and who did not have to face the want, basically, and therefore, you know, they directed them primarily at the government. They were now, these very principles are now being used to attack government and attack social support structures from the government and to promote neoliberals and privatization, which actually puts more people under authoritarian governance, not necessarily government, by private corporations, by their employers, which puts them subject to labor abuses, just, you know, like labor, unsafe labor conditions, and, you know, threat, and also intimidation, violence from, you know, private security or hired police as private security, and all sorts of issues. So, like, what is your take on, like, these, on civil and political rights, which are considered to be a good thing, but actually, you know, like, possibly, you know, having an unintentional side effect of actually increasing oppression?
Hi, what's your name?
Ephraim Galkin.
Oh, thank you. I appreciate that. That's a big one. A couple big ones. So the first one, in terms of freedom of expression. So there are limits on freedom of expression. Okay, and so like you and I can't go to the middle of a movie theater and yell fire, right? You can't. Your freedom of speech cannot affect the public safety, right? And this is, and there's a constant tension in this in terms of, you know, what's allowed. And there's this whole idea of like, and this is something that's playing out right now. I mean, this is a horrible, but also an absolutely fascinating time to be alive, because these are such real issues where people are wrestling with this idea of where does freedom of speech begin and end, and where does hate speech begin? And various countries have different interpretations of this. But anyway, and also, you know, if you criticize your boss, I don't think that's publicly, you know, that's not so much freedom of speech. That's like a sort of a personnel issue that really, I think it kind of goes beyond that. But anyway, let me say, I'm not a lawyer. I'm just a former journalist who knows a little bit about human rights. In terms of your other ideas, it's a lot, and I'm going to try to answer it this way. I think that you were going down the right alley when you basically said who is sort of behind in formulating these ideas, and who's in the human rights movement. And I think it's important that to recognize that the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was not like this Western idea, that it had input from Chinese delegates who brought in, like, there are elements of the UDHR that reflect elements of Confucianism and Taoism, that there were African and Indian inputs. And so it was an international multicolor input. It wasn't like a bunch of old white guys. But having said that, there is and has been, and continues to be, like, a diversity problem in, I think, the nonprofit sector generally, and I think that's also reflected in the human rights movement, and that also determines, you know, to a certain extent, what issues are deemed as relevant, what issues are deemed less relevant. So if you're dealing with, like, if it's me, I'm like an old white guy who, from middle class background, you know, I don't have that much experience with privation and lack of economic access or security. And so, you know, my view of something is very different from somebody who is, working his behind off in three jobs, Amazon, a food cart, and something else to try to, you know, make the American dream. And so I think this has been part of the problem in terms of this emphasis on economic and social cultural rights. On top of what I said is that, of how this, like, it's a thornier issue in terms of how to engage. Like, what do you can tell a government, it's against the, you know, you cannot torture people. It's against international law. Boom. But it's like, you have to spend this much more on your hospitals. It's like, there's no metric for that. So that's why we're sort of playing catch up in terms of how do you address these rights in a way that's meaningful. I probably didn't answer your question, but I hope I got somewhere close to it.
Let me read a question from our colleague, Gohar Petrosian. What would you say is the best way to raise awareness on human rights abuses for the international community to move them to actually act when the perpetrator has various global, political, and economic influences that significantly limit the international community's ability to act?
Right, okay. All right, I'll answer that two ways. And the first thing I say is that let's start with this country. Like, the best way that this country or any individual country can advocate for human rights anywhere outside is to ensure that it respects those rights inside the country. Mm-hmm. So a country needs to live by these values in order to be able to meaningfully advocate for them outside of this country. And that's why I mentioned this issue of the right of asylum. Like, this is one of the key rights that was of the post-war period, this idea that people fleeing persecution, people fleeing imminent deadly danger, have a right to come into a country and ask for asylum and go through a process to determine whether it's justified or not, but they have that right. And this country has literally and figuratively built a wall and says, no longer. On top of this idea of like separating children and putting them in cages and never allowing them to find their parents again. The best way to raise, when the perpetrator has various global political influences, I would say that every perpetrator of human rights abuses has influence and links, has power. That's why they're able to perpetrate human rights abuses. Like, when we talk about human rights abuses, we're talking about agents of the state or the state. And so when you're engaging with a country that's doing terrible things, then you need to engage with them. And so first you need to expose it. You need to tell them to stop it. And then you have to bring in, and if they refuse to listen to you, then you need to bring in other levers, other elements, whether it's international organizations, whether it's the World Bank or the IMF, whether it's bilateral partners, like trading partners, like the United States, the UK. I mean, look, there are more than 1 million Uyghur Muslims in concentration camps in Xinjiang in China. This is an indisputable fact. This is horrific in any day and age, but in this day and age. And the fact is that China doesn't pay a price for this. And so, you know, for someone who's worked on China, this is, when does China pay the price, meaningful price in this, in terms of feeling that there is that what they do, that they don't get away with? I mean, it's not rocket science that it keeps happening. It's because no one pays any price for this. And it's because there's this perception, particularly in China, that the price of meaningfully engaging on human rights will be too costly in terms of economic gain, access to the Chinese market, access for Chinese for American companies to sell their stuff there, access for American companies to build their factories there and cheaply and then sell it back to the United States. I mean, this is just one example, but it comes down to that needs to be meaningful consequences. I hope that helps.
Okay.
Professor, you muted yourself again.
Any other questions? I see FM said that. Yes, I agree. Yeah. Yes, yeah. And yes, I agree. Yeah.
Yeah.
And the emphasis has been on the civil and political rights. I agree, absolutely.
Any other questions or comments? Well, if I may jump again, Phelim, over the... in the summer, we had a brainstorming session with some human rights activists, a group of us in academia, and some of us also in the group of academics have been also human rights activists during different phases in our lives. And we wanted to discuss what are the causes for the current predicament that the human rights discourse and activism face. That is, its appeal is eroding. And it is not, and you yourself pointed earlier on that contrast this period to the 90s, which was indeed the high point. human rights, the relevance of human rights as a tool of empowerment, as a tool for change, does not have the appeal that it used to be. Clearly, coronavirus has contributed to this problem and giving opportunity to strongmen to even use parts of human rights discourse to clamp down on freedom. Like, you know, there is an emergency, you have to restrict freedom of movement. Who has a problem with that? It has also been used as a, you know, easy, you know, tool to draw upon sometimes for their strongman's toolkit. Mm-hmm. One of the things that struck me from that conversation was how little introspection was among human rights activists on how they and their strategies might have been also partially responsible for the predicament that the human rights movement finds itself in. Mm-hmm. So as a long-standing activist and with a critical look, do you think that the human rights movements, yes, you can blame the strongman, then you can blame the coronavirus crisis, yes, you can blame Abu Ghraib and all these things, but what are we doing wrong that we don't have the appeal that we used to? And if we're to have this conversation, in your view, what are two or three issues that the human rights movement should discuss when they look themselves at their mirror, and try to understand the predicament that we are in? Mm.
Yeah, that's a really easy question, George. Thank you for that. So I would say, I mean, here's the first thing I would say. I mean, you touched on, and I touched on the issue of the strongmen. So I would say one issue, I think there was a certain level of complacency. You know, what we've seen is you look around the world, you look in this country, you look at Turkey with Erdogan, you look at Hungary with Orban, you look at Duterte in the Philippines. You know, the list goes on and on. You've had this rise. And I think that there was this idea going back 4 years ago that this is a glitch, you know, like what we're seeing and whatever appeal and, you know, that these people have, that it's a glitch. And I think we're and this too shall pass. And we can go back to normal. We got to live through this. And I think we're now at the point where we recognize it's not a, you know, this isn't a glitch. You know, this is a feature. This is staying. And obviously, and so there's a complacency. And of course, that complacency has been magnified by or amplified the fact that there was inadequate attention to issues of economic and social rights that has, to a certain extent, fed the appeal of demagogue, nativist, or nativist demagogue sort of peddling this poisonous narrative of, you know, the complex problems of today that are rooted in economic systems, economic inequality, the nature of the economic system itself, are due to an other of some kind, that you've lost your jobs because of those immigrants, that the Philippines context, that this nascent middle class that's sort of like just on the edge of maybe going back to poverty, your biggest enemy are those are the poor who use drugs, who might want to rob you. And I think that we didn't pay adequate, there wasn't adequate attention to how, you know, ignoring those types of issues would, in terms of the economics and economic equality and what we call economic justice, has fed this kind of, to a certain extent, a bedrock of disinterest or lack of investment by certain populations or portions of the population in the human rights project. This idea that we all have these certain rights and all need to be protected, that it comes down to there's some people who are a threat and we don't need them and we got to take care of ourselves. I know I answered that imperfectly, but from my perspective, and again, I'm just one little porthole on a huge ship. That's what I think was one of the bigger problems.
So I have another question.
Thank you, Phelim. Oh. Okay. Yes, Gabby.
So kind of building on what I understood from that question, kind of doing my own in that. So I feel like the UDHR got so much attention, like it was such a big thing because of it was so close to what happened during World War II, like the genocide and the Holocaust and everything.
Yeah.
But since then, there have been like multiple genocides or equally as horrific or almost, whatever, that's subjective. human rights events that have happened since the Holocaust, but people's interests still aren't as invested in human rights as they had been right after World War II. And I was wondering why you think that is, and as from what I can read, even in journalism, I've seen like people, like at least in like layouts of website news sources and like newspapers, I've seen where human rights issues and like violence aren't the focal point of these papers. It's more like a political scandal or a personal scandal in some big name in whatever country they're reporting on, as opposed to a human rights issue in the country they're reporting on.
Yeah.
So I was wondering why you think human rights, even though it's, like you said, like it's such a multifaceted thing where it ties in the economy and politics and like able-bodiedness and like class, why you think it's taken like such a backseat to big names and like, I guess big names in journalism. Like, I understand that you need like something exciting, I guess, to sell newspapers, but like, why are people's, I guess, suffering and the things happening to them not as big stories as people, as they should be, I guess.
Yeah. Thank you, Gabby. So the first question, you nailed it. You know, like 48, the Universal Declaration of Human Rights is promulgated. And again, it's aspirational. It's very general. It's like the mothership of general ideas that needed what in many countries, you know, you have a law and then you have like the implementing regulations. So here are the principles in the law. Here's how it works in terms of in reality. And you would have hoped that in 1948, when you have the law or the general aspirations, that you would have the implementing regulations by 1950, 1951, like within a few years. It took almost 30 years. And there's, you know, and the answer, the reason for that is it was the Cold War. And there was great dispute between the Soviet PAC nations, communist countries, authoritarian communist states like China and the Soviet Union, and the West as to what constitutes a right. What rights need to be primary. And so that's why we ended up with two documents. We have the civil and political rights, and we have the economic and social social and cultural rights, which are didn't come into reality until 1976. So there is, you know, three decades of mass killings, terror by state actors around the world, where there wasn't like the implementing regulations that maybe could have been applied in a way that something could have helped to prevent it, perhaps. And in terms of the Cold War, of course, I mentioned Indonesia. Indonesia was a stout, anti-communist state at a time when the United States was fighting the Vietnam War. And Henry Luce, who founded Time magazine. He was like, the family runs Time magazine. You know, he was quoted at the time when there were these reports of these tens of thousands and thousands of Indonesians being killed for being communists. He's a quote, he said, "This is the best news to come out of Asia in decades." There was this idea that this threat of communism, that you need to throw everything at it. And what they did is they threw every Indonesian at it. You know, so there was no justice or reprieve for Indonesians who were being killed because they were perceived communists. And, you know, vice versa in situations in which they're being victimized because they were, you know, seen as being not communist in communist regimes. So anyway, that's like a rough sort of answer on that. With regards to journalism, I think it depends what you read. And, you know, I would urge everybody to read The Guardian. You know, it's a British news platform, but it's international. It is a human rights environmental journalist enterprise. That's what they do. They do incredible work, and they're all about, I mean, they cover all the news, but they have a real interest and a real specialty that's explicit. Like, we cover human rights, and we cover environmental issues. And it's a point of pride. It's part of their selling point. And so, you know, it depends on the media that you're reading. And I see more and more, just the world that we're in, that the journalism that a lot of people, what I consider important journalism, it's human rights journalism, because they're covering stuff like anything happening in the border, that's human rights reporting. You know, anything happening in so many of these countries that I mentioned already, you know, this is by definition human rights. So, I mean, the Amazon burning, this is human rights, indigenous, you know, the rights of the indigenous peoples, the rights of people who are being thrown out off their land, the fact that it's accelerating climate change. So it all, I think it depends on your sources and your perspective. So an imperfect answer, but I hope it helps. Read The Guardian.
Thank you. And I worked on an immigration fellowship from Guatemala. So I appreciate you tying in the triangle countries, migrants being moved up. There's a lot of people like, that's not a big deal. I'm like, no, it is.
I think we have time for one more question, if there is one. Anybody? Well, okay. Then that brings us to the end of our session. I'm sure I'm expressing here everybody's appreciation to Phelim for his presentation and the patience and thoughtfulness with which he responded to our questions. He has really gotten us off to a great start. And Phelim, despite some misgivings, we are keeping the human rights flame alive, okay? Rest assured.
And can I speak to that? Because I don't want everyone to go home and just say, I'm done with this world and I'm not going to vote. I guess I'm just going to like sit in my house for a couple of months. So I just want to say, I'm going to steal a line from Philip Alston. Philip Alston is the most recent special rapporteur on economic rights. What? And he said, human rights are not a lost cause, but they're not a winning cause. They're an ongoing cause. I totally agree. Thank you. Solidarity, everybody.
Thank you very much, Phelim. I want to thank our co-sponsors for this event, which is the Master Program in International Crime and Justice, the Minor in Human Rights Studies, and Students Without Borders, and all of you for being with us this afternoon. Have a nice day, folks, and we'll see you next time. Goodbye.
Thank you. Take care.
Thank you.
Vote.